بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولقد نصركم الله ببدر وأنتم أذلة فاتقوا الله لعلكم تشكرون إذ تقول للمؤمنين ألن يكفيكم أن يمدكم ربكم بثلاثة آلاف من الملائكة منزلين بلى إن تصبروا وتتقوا ويأتوكم من فورهم هذا يمددكم ربكم بخمسة آلاف من الملائكة مسومين وما جعله الله إلا بشرى لكم ولتطمئن قلوبكم به وما النصر إلا من عند الله العزيز الحكيم All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower his choicest of blessings and salutations upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, first and foremost, I enjoin upon myself and then all of you all here to adopt a life of taqwa, and that is to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during every single second of our lives if we wish to attain success in this world as well as the hereafter. Secondly, I advise myself firstly again and then all of you all here not to latch yourselves onto this life of dunya. For the life of this dunya is very, very short. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with this life to prepare for the eternal akhirah, where that is going to be our perpetual residence, not this life of dunya. Look at this beautiful piece of poetry that was articulated by our beloved Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, who states, Inna lillahi ibadan futana. Inna lillahi ibadan futana. طلقوا الدنيا وخافوا الفتنة نظروا فيها فلما علموا أنها ليست لحي وطنا جعلوها لجة واتخذوا صالح الأعمال فيها سفنا الله أكبر Eloquent beautiful words إن لله عبادا فتنا Indeed Allah سبحانه وتعالى has intelligent slaves الله أكبر May Allah سبحانه وتعالى make us all from his intelligent slaves آمين Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has intelligent slaves. طلقوا الدنيا. They have basically divorced this dunya. They have abandoned this dunya. وَخَافُوا الْفِتَنَى And they fear the trials and tribulations of this dunya. نَظَرُوا فِيهَا They had a look at this dunya. فَلَمَّا عَلِمُوا أَنَّهَا لَيْسَتْ لِحَيٍّ وَطَنَى And when they realized that this dunya is not a place, is not a permanent place for the people who are truly alive, جَعَلُوهَا لُجَّةً They took it as a transitory stage. They made this dunya as a transitory station. وَاتَّخَذُوا صَالِحَ الْأَعْمَالِ فِيهَا سُفُنَا. And they took righteous actions, righteous deeds as a mode of conveyance to cross this transitory stage onto the permanent Akhirah. Allahu Akbar. So let us not latch ourselves onto this life of dunya, because it is extremely temporary, extremely short. The pleasures of this life are short-lived. The hardships of this life are short-lived. Nothing is permanent. Let us prepare for Akhirah. For that is what the history of Islam teaches us. The lives of Sahaba Ridwanullahi Ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To sum it all up, this is what it teaches us, that the life of this dunya is short. We are not here to live forever and ever. This blessed month of Ramadan that we are in, it is known as a month of victory. It is known as a month of victory because many decisive victories took place in this noble and blessed month. The month of Ramadan is such a blessed and virtuous month, so there is no wonder that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used this month to bring about decisive victories for the Muslim Ummah, such as the Battle of Badr, the great Battle of Badr, the Fath of Makkah, the conquest of Makkah, the conquest of Andalus, which was spearheaded by Tariq ibn Ziyad. Battles against the Mongolians, against the Tatars, which resulted in astounding victories for the Muslim Ummah. Battles such as Ain Jalut, Hittin, which was spearheaded by Salahuddin al-Ayyubi against the Crusaders. All of which were in the month of Ramadan, and all of which were decisive and astounding victories for the Muslim Ummah, because the Muslim Ummah at that time realized that this life is not a life to latch ourselves onto, and they placed their firm trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah the Almighty brought about great victories. Today, wherever we look around, the Muslim Ummah is being battered from all four corners. The Muslim Ummah has been thrown from the frying pan right into the fire. And when we talk about fire, let's not forget the Khalil of Allah, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, who was the single believer at that time, whilst the whole world disbelieved in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was the single believer, and due to that belief, and because he called towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the kuffar, they made a huge fire, and Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam was catapulted into that fire. And look at the beautiful statement Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, the great Khalil of Allah, utters at that moment. Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakil, ni'mal mawla wa ni'mal nasir. Hasbunallah, Allah is sufficient for us. Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakil. Allah is sufficient for us. Allah is the best protector. Allah is the best person to put your affairs in. Allah is the best person to keep your affairs with. Allah is the best protector. Allah is the best helper. It is Allah the Almighty that we need to be turning towards, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. And coming back to this noble month of Ramadan and the decisive battle of Badr. This battle, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, was indeed a great battle, which was recorded in the annals of history. A battle that was an astounding victory for the Muslims, for the Muslim Ummah at large. This battle took place on the 17th of Ramadan, in this very month. 1400 odd years ago, 2 years after the Hijrah, after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba Ridwanullah ta'ala alayhim ajma'in migrated to Medina, 2 years after the Hijrah, this battle took place. Allahu Akbar. And this battle, how did it begin? There was a caravan heading from Sham towards Mecca, a caravan that belonged to the Quraysh. Specifically, it belonged to Abu Sufyan. It belonged to the Quraysh, and this caravan was headed from Sham, Damascus, towards Mecca. The news goes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam declares that the Sahaba Ridwanullahi Ta'ala alayhi majma'in and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the Muslim army should intercept that caravan and take hold of that caravan. Because the Muslims, when they were in Mecca, their wealth were plundered. They were boycotted and they were driven out of their homes. They had to leave their wealth, their homes, their personal belongings and migrate to Medina. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam saw this as an opportunity to take back what belonged to them. And remember, whatever said and done, it was a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيُّ يُوحَىٰ. He does not speak out of his own desires. Whatever he speaks is divine revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it was the command of Allah. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam gathered the Sahaba Ridwanullah ta'ala alayhi majma'in and called out for who to call, and he mustered an army to head over and intercept the caravan of the Quraysh. Now the caravan of the Quraysh had valuable belongings, and the news that had traveled to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was that there were only 40 men guarding the caravan whilst it was traveling from Sham to Mecca. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam gathers 300 or 313 men and they go ahead to intercept this caravan. Now what happens is Abu Sufyan, in general, he was a person who had a very guilty conscience because of all the evil that he had inflicted upon the Muslims when they were in Mecca. So he always had this feeling, he had this fear, this apprehension that any time the Muslims might attack us. So he used to take a lot of precaution. At times, even when he used to go on business trips and when the caravan had to cross from long distances towards Mecca, he used to send riders ahead to check on the situation. And this was one time when he personally went to check on the situation. And when he went, they go by a well, a particular well. And when they reach that well, Abu Sufyan, he notices that there were droppings of camels left behind, the dung of camels. So he goes by the dung of these camels, he takes it in his hand and he crushes it. The minute he crushes it, he realizes, in other words, he had the expertise to do so, he realized that these, in other words, the camels had been fed with the dates of Yathrib, the dates of Medina. So he cries out, these camels have been fed with the dates of Medina. That means the Muslims are trying to intercept our caravan. Immediately send a distress call to Mecca for them to send reinforcements to help us. Allahu Akbar. And at this time, an amazing event took place in Mecca. Atika bint Abdul Muttalib radiallahu anha, who embraced Islam later on, she was the aunt of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. She sees a dream. She sees a dream in which a horse rider comes galloping towards Mecca and cries out a distress call. He cries out, help, help, that we are being attacked. And then he climbs a mountain hill and he throws a rock, a huge rock, which knocks on the ground and shatters into pieces, and the pieces knock all of the houses in Mecca. Some scholars are of the opinion that that rock in the dream of Atika radiallahu anha, that rock actually spoke and told the Meccans that death is approaching towards y'all. She took this dream as a dream that was a bad omen, and she went and informed Al-Abbas, the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. She informed him of the dream. The minute Al-Abbas radiallahu anhu, he heard about the dream, he told her, don't tell anyone about this dream, keep it to yourself. But he himself could not contain himself and he started telling people, until eventually the news goes to Abu Jahl. Abu Jahl comes directly to Al-Abbas, the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and asks him, now we already have people, we have from the men people who are getting revelation, now do we have women also getting revelation? Are we having women who are also getting divine revelation to predict the destruction of the Meccans? to which he insults Al-Abbas radiallahu anhu, and he moves away. The people around Al-Abbas, the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they say, "Ya Abbas, you are just keeping quiet. Whilst he insulted you and he insulted your sister, how dare you keep quiet? Go and ask him what his problem is." Al-Abbas radiallahu anhu then, he goes up to Abu Jahl and he goes up to ask him why he had insulted his own sister Atika bint Abdul Muttalib. When they met face to face, they made eye contact, and Al-Abbas was about to fire at him, ask him the question. A horse rider comes galloping into Makkah crying out, "Help, help! The caravan of the Quraysh is about to be intercepted and the caravan is about to be attacked. We need reinforcements to go and help that caravan." Allahu Akbar. The dream, it was not even 3 days and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought about that dream. Allahu Akbar. So nevertheless, Abu Jahl, now the minute he hears this news, he musters an army. He musters an army which was 1,000 strong. Allahu Akbar. 1,000 strong. They had 700 camels, 100 horses, and all of these camels, horses and soldiers, they march out to protect the caravan of the Quraysh. Now Abu Sufyan in general, who was a very clever and cunning individual, he takes a detour. He takes a detour the minute he found out that the Muslims are trying to intercept his caravan, and he reaches Makkah safely. The minute he reached Makkah, he informed Abu Jahl. He informed the Meccans, "I have reached Makkah safely. There is no need to fight the Muslims. Y'all can head back." So many of the Meccans at that time, they also thought it is best that we head back. There is no need for bloodshed. There is no need for a fight. Because after all, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, something to be highlighted is that the Battle of Badr was a battle between oppressors, between tyrants, and between weak people. The Battle of Badr was between large numbers and small numbers. The Battle of Badr was between Haqq and between Batil. The Battle of Badr was between truth and between falsehood. The help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was with the Muslims, because the Battle of Badr was a battle of Al-Wala and Al-Bara. Because the Battle of Badr was amongst family members. Allahu Akbar. Cousins were fighting cousins. Uncles were fighting nephews. And brothers were fighting brothers. Fathers were fighting sons. This battle was between family members. There was no other reason other than the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being raised high. Allahu Akbar. This was a decisive battle. And after all, the minute the news comes to the army that Abu Sufyan had reached Makkah safely, many of them decided there is no need to go and fight because our caravan has reached Makkah safely. But Abu Jahl, who was adamant, who was stubborn, that we need to teach the Muslims a lesson. We need to teach Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a lesson. He was adamant on marching ahead and facing the Muslim army and fighting them. So he says, "No, we have to march ahead and we have to win this battle and we have to celebrate afterwards by drinking alcohol, by partying, by making our women sing for us. We have to go ahead and fight the Muslim army to teach the Muslims a lesson, to teach Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a lesson." And this army, they march forward. Allahu Akbar. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, 1,000 men versus 313 men. 700 camels versus 70 camels. 100 horses versus 2 horses. Their numbers, the Muslim army was outnumbered. The odds were against them. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gets news of this huge army that is heading to fight them. He immediately calls for a shura. He immediately calls for a consultation, a mashura between the sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. And then he says to them, "Ashiru alaykum ayyuhal qawm. I ask your advice or your consultation in regard to this matter." He wanted to know the pulse of the sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. To which immediately Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu stands up and says, "Ya Rasulullah, You can march ahead. We are right behind you, Ya Rasulullah. Wherever you go, we go. Allahu Akbar. And then Umar radiallahu anhu stands up and he says something similar. Ya Rasulullah, you can march ahead. We are right behind you. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam still kept asking for their advice and their consultation. And then Miqdad ibn al-Aswad radiallahu anhu, he stands up and says, he says a profound statement, an astounding statement. Ya Rasulullah, do you think that we will reply like how Banu Israel replied to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam? Do you think that we will say, idhab anta wa rabbuk faqatila inna hahuna qa'idun? Do you think that we will say, you and your Lord go and fight whilst we sit back and watch the entertainment? Nay, Ya Rasulullah, we say, you and your Lord, you go and fight and we are right behind you, Ya Rasulullah. We will be right behind you. Allahu Akbar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once more asks, give me your consultation, O my Sahaba. And then Sa'd ibn Mu'ad radiallahu anhu, a great Sahabi, the leader of the Ansar, a Sahabi at his death, the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shook. The arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala trembled. He stands up and he says, Ya Rasulullah, we are right behind you, Ya Rasulullah. We believe in you, Ya Rasulullah. We believe in what you have brought, Ya Rasulullah. Even if you were to march into the ocean, even if you were to march into the sea, we will follow right behind you, Ya Rasulullah. Sir ala barakatillah. Sir ala barakatillah. March ahead with the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Go ahead with the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are right behind you. We the Ansar are right behind you, Ya Rasulullah. And you have all right to use us in any way you want. You can use our wealth. You can use our assets in any way you wish, Ya Rasulullah. Because what you take and what you use is more beloved to us than what you leave behind for us. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. No wonder the Ansar enjoyed such a great status in the sight of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, now reassured, he gathers the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in and pitches camp waiting for the Kuffar army to come to them. And at that time, another Sahabi, if I'm not mistaken, Al-Hubbab ibn Mundhir, he goes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and he asks Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, you are pitching camp here. Is it the decision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Or is it a strategy of war that you are deploying? To which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam replied, it is a strategy of war. It is a stratagem of war that I have deployed. And then he advises, Ya Rasulullah, I suggest that we camp further down south and that we make a small well for us and let us block all other wells, restricting access of water for the Quraysh. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam accepted his mashura and they camped further down south and restricted the other wells so that the Quraysh would not have access to water. That night Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was in ibadah. He was sincerely praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because the next day would be the day of the battle. He prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fervently throughout the night. Allahu Akbar. These are the real mujahideen. They are the ones who spend the nights in prayer and the mornings fighting for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fervently throughout the night. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed the Muslim army in such a way, even though they were so nervous, even though they were so tense, Allah blessed them with a peaceful sleep so that they slept the whole night peacefully. The next day morning comes and then the Kuffar army has reached. Once again I remind you of the numbers, 1000 versus 313, 700 camels versus 70 camels, 100 horses versus 200 horses. And my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the Kuffar army was armed to the teeth. They were armed to the teeth with all of the best weaponry available. Whilst the Muslims, half of them were not even armed. Allahu Akbar. Half of them did not have proper shields to protect themselves. The battle begins. There were three duels that took place before the battle, and after that the battle rages on. Allahu Akbar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just before the battle, he says, "O my Sahaba, Allah the Almighty has promised victory for us." And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes around the battlefield and he points out, "This is where Abu Jahl will die. This is where Umayyah will die. This is where so and so will die. That is where so and so will die." All of which was taught by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Umar radiallahu anhu states, "Wallahi, right after the battle, we witnessed the statements of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as being true, because wherever Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that this individual will die on this place, that person was dead there." Allahu Akbar. The battle rages on. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam raises his hands and prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Ya Allah, if the Muslim army is defeated today, there will be no one to worship you, Ya Allah. Send down your help, Ya Allah. Help us, Ya Allah." He is in sincere dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fervently making dua, so much to the extent that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu cries out, "Ya Rasulullah, it is enough, it is enough. Allah's help is imminent, Allah's help is coming. Do not worry. Inevitably the help of Allah will come. You are seeking so much of dua, your dua will be answered." Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to pray, and then Allahu Akbar, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam suddenly looks up to the heavens, and Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam descends from the heavens. Archangel Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam with an army of 3,000 angels. Allahu Akbar. The help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came down immediately. Allahu Akbar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam takes a handful of dust and recites, "سَيُهْزَمُ الْجَمْعُ وَيُوَلُّونَ الدُّبُرُ," and he throws it at the kuffar. At that time, the translation of the ayah is that the great numbers will be defeated and they will show their backs and they will run. But the amazing part, as stated by Umar radiallahu anhu, was that this ayah was revealed in Makkah. This ayah came down in Makkah. The minute the ayah came down, Umar radiallahu anhu was surprised. He asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "Ya Rasulullah, who are these large numbers and who will turn back, showing their backs? Who are these people?" To which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kept quiet. And then Umar radiallahu anhu states, "On this day, on the day of Badr, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recited the ayah, I understood why the ayah came down." Allahu Akbar. Now when the help of Allah came down, the Muslim army started charging ahead. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started encouraging the Muslims to go ahead. He started reciting the ayah, "وَسَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ أُعِدَّتْ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ." Rush towards the forgiveness of your Lord. Rush towards a Jannah, a paradise. The real estate is the seven heavens and the seven earths combined together. The square footage of that Jannah would be the seven heavens and the seven earths combined together. It has been prepared specially for the people of Taqwa. Allahu Akbar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kept on reciting this ayah, and the Muslim army defeated the kuffar, resulting in an astounding and a decisive victory for the Muslim Ummah, which has been recorded in the annals of history. Allahu Akbar. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, so many lessons to be derived from this battle, but the primary lesson is to never lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To never lose hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Keep your trust firmly in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your numbers may be small. Your numbers may be small, but the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is inevitable if we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and if we mend our ways. All of what we see happening around us is nothing but trials and calamities. Trials and calamities that should turn us and make us turn towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That should make us get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we wish to attain victory here, and if we wish to attain success in this world as well as the hereafter, I leave you all with a hadith, an authentic hadith which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said. The hadith goes along the lines of these words: towards the latter stages, nations will gather, and they will start calling one another, just as how you call people to partake of food, just as how you invite one another to partake of food. Nations will gather, Allahu Akbar, nations will gather, and they will call one another to annihilate, to destroy the Muslim Ummah. Towards the latter stages, this will happen. And at that time, the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, they asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, will we be few in number at that time? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stated, nay, you will be like the froth of the sea. You will be in large numbers. You will be like the froth of the sea. But the fear for you all will be taken away from the enemies of Islam, and wahan will be cast in your hearts. Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in asked, Ya Rasulullah, what is al-wahan? What is wahan? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then clarified, wahan will be the love for this materialistic dunya and the fear to meet malakul maut, the fear to meet death. Wahan is love for this materialistic dunya and fear to meet malakul maut. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, there is no harm in amassing millions. There is no harm in buying expensive motor vehicles. There is no harm in building mansions. Nothing is haram. But we need to get our priorities straight. Are we going to live here forever? Are we going to take those expensive motor vehicles with us to the qabr? Are we going to take those expensive mansions with us to the qabr? Are we going to take all of those designer brands with us to the qabr? Nay, we will be wrapped with one single white shroud, which at times might be bought not with our money, maybe someone else might buy it for us. The only thing that will travel with us to the qabr will be our righteous deeds. So let us put our priorities straight, and let us not love this dunya. Let us not latch ourselves onto this dunya. But on the other hand, let's prepare for akhirah, because we have been sent to this dunya to prepare for akhirah, and we are not afraid to meet malakul maut because we are eager to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let us prepare for that meeting. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins. May He the Almighty accept our good deeds. And may He unite us in the gardens of Jannah with our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just as how He united us here this afternoon. And may He the Almighty help us to make